Excel's new Incell checkboxes that are currently available in the 365 beta channel are so versatile. We can use them for task lists where we can filter out tasks that are complete, progress tracking that displays the status complete, dynamic charts where you can turn off and on what series you want to see, and filtered lists that allow you to select what to include, to name a few. And because it's essentially a type of format, you can color them, align them, make them bigger or smaller. We can check them with the mouse or in bulk by pressing the space bar. And we can reference the true or false values they return in formulas and apply conditional formatting, among other things. Let's look at four practical examples of how we can exploit these features to create some cool, user-friendly tools. And stay tuned for the limitations so you don't waste time trying to make them do things they weren't intended for. Here I have a packing list for things I want to take on an upcoming trip. And I already have some items, which I just need to pack, and others that I'll need to buy. I can use checkboxes to make it quick and easy to keep track. You'll find them on the Insert tab over on the far right. That's great. Now I can simply check the items off, but it would be more helpful if I can return a status and then filter the list to remove any items that I've packed. And we can do that with an if formula that references the true and false values returned by the checkbox. So I'll start by checking the status of column D. If this is true, I'll return the text packed. Notice here I don't need to say if this cell equals true because the checkbox returns true or false. I can simply reference the cell. Otherwise, if column C is true, then I simply need to pack it, and if it's false, I'll need to buy it. Now I can use conditional formatting to make the items I need to focus on stand out more. So I'll select the whole table, and then on the Home tab, Conditional Formatting, New Rule. Here, I want to use a formula to determine which cells to format. The formula will be applied where this cell is true, and because the checkbox returns a true when checked, I simply reference the checkbox cell for the packed column. Now, I need to remove the dollar sign from the row number so that the conditional format references each row in the table. Now, I can set up the formatting for the font with strike through and in a light gray color to de-emphasize it. I'll click OK and OK. Now I could also filter out items that are packed, but as more items are packed, I'll need to manually go in and reapply the filter, so it's not ideal. We can use checkboxes to keep track of progress. For example, here I've got a manufacturing checklist, and I've already set up some conditional formatting to color the status, but I'd also like to display a progress bar and status. I'll start by calculating the percentage complete, and I need to handle errors with if error in case an item hasn't started. Then with count if, I can count how many steps in the process are true. Notice I didn't put true in double quotes like you'd normally do with text, and that's because it's not text. Not many Excel users know that true and false values are a Boolean data type that Excel recognizes. That said, you can wrap them in double quotes and the formula will still work. It's just not required. Okay, next I'll divide it by the count of how many tasks I have. I could hard key this value, but I like my formulas to be able to update, and if I add more tasks to the process, this will be handy. All right, finally, if the formula returns an error, I'll get it to return blank. Next, I'll select these cells and on the Home tab of the ribbon, Conditional Formatting, Data Bars, and I'll select this blue color. I don't really want blue, so let's go in and edit the rules. I'll double click to edit it and change the color to light gray, which will allow numbers to show through more clearly. Now for the status, I can use if to check if materials have been sourced yet. If they have, then I'll use the switch function to take the progress percentage, and if it's at 25% or 0.25, then return raw materials. If it's at 1, then it's finished goods. And if it's in between these values, then it's work in progress. And everything else hasn't started, so it must be get raw materials. Let's check some boxes to test it out. All right, that looks good. Now, in the interest of time, I won't go over the color conditional formatting because it's similar to the previous example, but you can download the file from the video description and check it out there. This chart displays data that spans a large scale. The larger values diminish the volatility of the green and blue lines, so they appear fairly smooth in comparison to the purple and orange lines. But with checkboxes, we can easily remove series from the chart to allow for a better understanding of each series. To set this up, I have my data on a separate sheet in a table called Data, which we can see here. For this video, I have the chart data beside the chart, but in practice, you probably hide it away on another sheet. I'll delete the first two columns to show you how it's constructed. The first column simply returns the date column of the table. It's a table column reference, so it spills the whole column. And this also means that if we add new data to that table, this formula is going to automatically pick it up and include it in the chart. Next, I can use XLOOKUP to look up the dates. I'll use the hash operator to reference the spilled list of dates, and that way XLOOKUP will always pick up that new data as well. And I'm looking up the data table, date column, and referencing the data table, Dow Jones column, close parentheses for XLOOKUP. Now here comes the trick. If the checkbox for this index is selected, it will return true, and if I apply a math operator to true or false, they will convert to their numeric equivalents of 1 and 0. So all I need to do is multiply XLOOKUP by the checkbox cell to either display or hide the series in the chart. That is, when a box is unchecked, the XLOOKUP is being multiplied by 0, and when it's checked, it's being multiplied by 1, so it displays. Now, when a series is unchecked, it's actually plotting zeros, and you can see the line just at the bottom of the chart. If you prefer to hide the line altogether, we can change it to an if formula that returns an NA if the checkbox is unselected. For example, I'll edit this and put if at the front. So if C4, then my XLOOKUP, then if false, will return NA. Now, if I select the Dow Jones index, the line isn't in the chart at all. We can team Incell checkboxes up with the filter function to enable users to select what data they want returned in a table. The source data is in a table called Financials, as you can see here. It has some helper columns in H through J that indicate if the segment, country, and product are selected in the checkboxes on the filter sheet, and they use XLOOKUP. I'll delete the first one to show you how it works. So equals XLOOKUP to look up the segment. In the filter sheet's list of segments, and this is a dynamic array, so Excel uses the hash operator to reference it. Then I need to F4 to absolute that reference. Then I want to return the checkbox status from column C for each segment. Again, F4 to absolute. And you can see it checks each row and returns true or false accordingly. And I've inserted the same formula for country and product. The next step is to reference these helper columns with the filter function to return the rows that have true in each of the helper columns. I'll delete the filter formula and step through writing it. So I want to filter the data columns, segment through date. I don't want to return the helper columns. The next argument tells filter which rows to return. I only want it to return rows where all three helper columns return true. So I'll multiply them by one another. This will result in 1 where all columns are true and 0 where any column is false. And filter will only return rows where that result is 1. Next, I'll return some text if no checkboxes are selected. We'll just say no data available. And you can see the data returned. But it'd be nice if the column headers also came through. So let's add VStack to bring them in. So I'll insert it at the front and simply reference the first 6 columns of the table. And there we go. Now you can see I've also used conditional formatting to highlight rows that match the selected items, which in the interest of time, I'll let you explore in the completed file. So there are 4 cool ways to use the new checkboxes. Let's look at the limitations. You can trigger checking a checkbox with a formula, but you can't also check it manually. For example, if I check that I've packed an item without first checking that I have an item, it'd be good to have this box auto-checked. Now I can insert a formula to reference the checked cell in column D, but I can't then also check or uncheck the box, so this is a non-starter. If I want to add an item to the list, It'd be cool if the checkbox automatically filled down, but it doesn't. I'll delete that because I can add checkboxes in anticipation of adding more data, then delete them. Notice as I move my mouse over the cells, they appear like ghosts. That's because the format is still there. If I add my new item now, I can click those ghosted checkboxes to enable them. It's not perfect, but you might find this feature useful. If you want to remove those ghosted checkboxes, you need to go to the Home tab and then Clear Formats. Now, if you don't have the new checkboxes, you can achieve similar results with the original form control checkboxes. So check out that video next, no pun intended, or my in-depth conditional formatting with formulas video to bring your checkboxes to life. See you in the next video.